After having talked about auditory transduction, the way that sounds become electrical activity, I'm going to show you now one case of interesting processing of sounds, and specific of the electrical activity that results from sounds. And specifically, I want to discuss the issue of auditory localization. We can identify the direction of sound source of objects by the sound that they emit. So we hear a sound and we will turn our head towards the sound. This is a very interesting use of sound, and the reason is that there's no explicit representation of sound direction in the ear. The ear has, well, a sound. So identification of sound direction requires comparing the sound that reaches the two ears, and therefore the auditory localization requires computation. It requires the information from the two ears to reach the central nervous system and get processed there. So how do we know which the direction of sound? What are the physical cues that we can use in order to identify the direction of a sound source? These cues have to do with the sounds reaching the two ears, and so they are called binaural cues. Binaural means things that happen in the two ears separately. We are going to discuss only the localization of pure sine waves, pure frequencies. And when a pure sine wave reaches the ears, it has two types of physical differences. It produces two types of physical differences in the two ears. First of all, it reaches first the near ear and only then the far ear. So there's a slight shift in time, a minute shift in time of arrival of the sound to the two ears. And secondly, the head acts roughly as a shadow. So the sound is going to be louder in the near ear and slightly softer in the far ear. Thus, if I put microphones in the two ears and I present a sine wave, I record the sound in the two ears, I will find two sine waves. The sine wave in the near ear is going to be earlier and louder. We call the time differences between the two waves the interaural time differences. Again, interaural mean between the two ears. So interaural time differences, or ITDs, and the level differences are the interaural level differences, ILDs. I'm going to discuss mostly the calculation of the ITDs, of the interaural time differences. These time differences between the peak of the sine waves reaching each of the ear are really small. When we are talking about human heads, the distance between the two ears is something like 25 centimeters. And the time that takes the sound to move from one ear to the next, to the other, is less than 1 millisecond. If we are talking about the ability to discriminate between the location of two sound sources in front of you, we can identify differences on the order of a few degrees. And the time differences between a sound that is straight ahead will reach the two ears at the same time, and a sound that is shifted by a few degrees from the center will reach the closed ear a few tens of microseconds earlier than the other ear. So we are capable of discriminating interaural time differences of few tens of microseconds. That's hundredths of a millisecond. The important property that allows the auditory system to know when these peaks of the sine wave occur is called phase locking. It turned out that when the auditory auditory nerve fibers that are sensitive to the relevant range of frequencies, low frequencies, when the auditory nerve fibers fire, they fire at a fixed relationship to the shape of the incoming sound. So if I excite the, if I play a sine wave to the ear and I record the spikes that occur during the presentation of this sound, these spikes are going to happen, in this case, mostly at the peak of the sine waves. So the time at which spikes occur mark the peaks, the pressure maxima in the incoming sound. And this is true for both ears. So now when the two, when the sound reaches the two ears at slightly different times, these spikes are going to occur at slightly different times in one ear relative to the other. This is a complex slide. I'm going to explain to go over it very slowly, and it describes the pathway that is involved in the calculation of the interaural time differences. So first of all, we have the ears, right ear and left ear, and the sound reaching the two ears. The ear canal, the tympanic membrane, and here's the cochlea. These large circular structures are part of the vestibular system that's involved in balance. So the auditory nerve comes out of the cochlea, goes into the central nervous system, and ends in a structure called the cochlear nucleus. So we have the ear, the auditory nerve, and the cochlear nucleus from this one side, and the ear, the cochlea, and the cochlear nucleus from the other side. The auditory nerve fiber terminate in the cochlear nucleus. They make very large synapses on the relevant neurons in the cochlear nucleus, and these neurons now send their axons to a third structure that sits not far from the cochlear nuclei called the medial superior olive. I wanted to show you a little bit a rough view of the brain in order to for you to have an idea of where these structures lie. So this is a representation of part of the brain called the brainstem. The brainstem comes out of the skull. So from here down, we have the spinal cord. The spinal cord goes, enters the skull, and becomes the brainstem. On the brainstem, we have the two cochlear nuclei. So the ears, one ear sits here, the other ear sits here, and the cochlear, the auditory nerves come out of the ear, crosses the bone, and goes into the cochlear nucleus. The right ear to this cochlear nucleus and the left ear to that cochlear nucleus. Slightly further forward in the brainstem, we have the nuclei that together form the so-called superior olivary complex, and the MSO, the medial superior olive, is part of the superior olivary complex. The neurons of the MSO have dendrites pointing to the two sides. One side gets the input from the axons of the cochlear nucleus of the same side, and the other side, the dendrites of the other side of the neuron, get inputs that come on axons that come from the other side, from the other ear. How does this work? The point to notice in this diagram, the crucial point to notice in this diagram, is that the axon from this ear is a bit shorter than the axon from the other ear. The reason for that is simply distance. This superior olive sits closer to its cochlear nucleus than it sits to the cochlear nucleus from the other side. So we have slightly longer axons. Next, We know that action potential propagation along an axon takes time. There's a finite velocity, so the longer the axon, the longer it will take for the spike to go from the cell body to the axon terminals. In consequence, a spike that occurs on this side of the brain will reach the neuron in the MSO slightly earlier than a spike that occurs, or slightly faster than a spike that occurs on this side. Okay, now assume that a sound occurs on the right side. This sound will reach the right ear first and the left ear a little bit later, 300 microseconds later, let's say. The spikes that are locked to the peaks of the sine wave will occur 300 microseconds earlier here than here. However, this axon is longer, and if its length is such that the travel time from this cochlear nucleus to the MSO is exactly 300 microseconds longer than the travel time from this cochlear nucleus to the MSO, the spikes that originated from this ear will reach the MSO at exactly the same time as the spikes that originated from that ear. In consequence, the spikes reaching the MSO neurons from both sides will arrive at the same time, and these MSO neurons have a special property. They are coincidence detectors. They fire mostly when spikes occur simultaneously on both sides. So the MSO will see the spikes at the same time, and the reason that it will see the spikes at the same time is because of this internal delay caused by the axon length, and it will fire. On the other hand, for this specific neuron, if the sounds come exactly from the middle, the spikes will occur at the same time, locked to the peaks that occur at the same time in both ears. The delay due to the longer path length here, the axon length here, will cause the spikes to reach the MSO neuron at slightly different times on the two dendrites, and then the MSO neuron will not see the spikes at the same time, and so it will not fire. In summary, we got here a circuit that is sensitive to the time of arrival, to the interaural time difference. It fires, in this case, this neuron fires when the sound arrives at the right ear first and at the left ear later, and it doesn't fire when the sound reaches the two ears at the same time. So this neuron can tell us that the sound came from the right rather than from the center, or obviously from the left. This circuit requires extreme specialization of the biophysics of the neurons that participate in it. The reason is that it needs to keep the timing of the spikes extremely precisely all the way from the auditory nerve through the cochlear nucleus until they reach the MSO. And this is done by neurons in the cochlear nucleus that are specialized not to do anything to the input except for relaying it to the output. You learned with Idan a lot about what neurons can do, dendritic calculations, temporal summation, spatial summation, and so on and so forth. The neurons in the cochlear nucleus that participate in this circuit are designed so that they don't do anything any of these things. The only thing that they do is to produce a spike with very small jitter for every spike that reaches them from the auditory nerve. Secondly, the neurons that do the coincidence detection in the medial superior olive are also very special in terms of both of their structure and of their biophysical mechanisms. And the reason there again is that they need the this coincidence detection process that they participate in requires sensitivity to time differences of tens of microseconds. You learned with Idan that a spike width is order of 1 millisecond. That's 1,000 microseconds. So we have spikes whose width is hundreds of microseconds, maybe 1,000 microseconds. And with these extremely wide things, we need to be able to discriminate inter-oral time differences of a few tens of microseconds. So we cannot allow ourselves any jitter. We need a neuron whose temporal summation properties work with time constants that are extremely short. There are other problems, other issues that these neurons have to solve as well. And in fact, it turns out that some of these problems that are due to the attempt to discriminate tens of microseconds with BioWare, LifeWare, whose time constants are much longer, some of these problems are probably solved by using tricks that have to do with the properties of dendrites. This is as far as I want to go into the description of the ITD, of the inter-oral time difference calculation, but I want to remark that similar mechanisms can be observed throughout the sensory systems. Sensory systems each has its own specialized needs and specialized calculation that needs to be done. I showed you here the comparison of timing between the two ears. There's a parallel pathway that calculates the interaural level differences, the differences in the amplitude of the two sounds that reach the two ears. And in other sensory systems, you find other such computational tasks that are done by neurons. For example, the retina contains neurons that calculate motion, that are sensitive to motion, and that react to motion in one direction but not in other directions. So this is a kind of calculation that's done by the retina. Early processing of smells also has its own share of specialized calculations that needs to be done, and all of these specialized needs are catered in different sensory systems by different specialized circuits. So, for example, in the auditory system, we have these specialized circuits in the auditory brainstem. They are specialized in terms of the neurons that live there. They are specialized in terms of the connectivity between them. And they are specialized in terms of the computations that they perform. Similarly, in the retina, there are a lot of different circuits which are now starting to get dissected out and that perform all of these specialized calculations that are specific to the visual system. And similarly, in the for the smell sense, there's a structure called the olfactory bulb which gets the input from the nose and again has a specialized circuitry that performs the early processing that is specific to the olfactory system. And all of this, again, come with a lot of important, fascinating details, and I urge you to go and look for them. So this is what I wanted to discuss with respect to early processing of sensory information.